finished up on Cursed Hollow. Now, for game number three, we are going to Towers of Doom. Oh my gosh, give me the Stitches pick, please, JPL. But also, something to consider is that this is a battleground that we've seen pretty often. We've seen a lot of comebacks on. It's just been one of my favorite to watch so far in the last couple of weeks.
And, you know, giving... It's you walk this really weird line where you don't necessarily want to give Dingtas first pick, but you really, in my mind, I don't think you want to give the map pick either.
Sure.
And so you end up on Towers of Doom, which is a really good map for Team Dignitas. So I think Tricked Esports is in kind of a pretty rough spot going up against one of the big three.
Yeah, I gotta agree with you. They're also gonna be getting it feels like in the meta right now, the advantage is actually to have second pick. Starting to feel like, because you have a foundation that you can set up. It's all about the banning though. What do you ban out? Does the opponent get ready for it? Do they have a first pick they want to run with? For the most part, it feels like Dignitas is going more Falstad route. Whenever they get the chance, and so we need to keep an eye on that. Also, ETC. So Tricked Esports going into this, maybe they give them the first pick. Fine, you take your ETC, but we have a really strong second and third, or first and second pick.
It's been a big debate in the community, hasn't it, for a long time. A lot of people thought first pick was OP for a long time. I think some people still kind of do feel that way.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's still up for deliberation, I feel. As for now, Team Dignitas here going to go for their ban. So Falstad banned by Trick. This is no doubt going to be Tassadar on the other side.
Cool. So this gives Tricked Esports the first pick for the first time, it feels like, in the series. So we'll see what they're going to take away as their first pick.
Imagine if it's Tychus. It's just...
It's been Tychus in the past, but they finally pull out the Ragnaros. Tricked Esports is willing to put it all on the line here. They currently have, gosh, this is going to sound really horrible. They have a 1-win and 8-lose record in the HEC.
Yeah.
This is very important for them to start getting a flow and figure out what's going on for them. And you know what? Pull out the Ragnaros. They have yet to do it. This is their first time having it on their team.
Yeah, the Falstad ban for them is kind of like, we care what we're banning, but we just don't want have to have Ragnaros banned so that we can guarantee it for ourselves for the first pick. So that's nice. I do want to reiterate the fact that Tricked Esports here, whilst they're a new formation of a team, they've gone up against some of the hardest opponents in the league so far, and there's still many weeks to come for them.
Yes, and this is where they can start getting that momentum, start getting the comeback. Yeah. Even if they get the win here and they still lose the series overall, just getting those wins feels great. Now, Dignitas can move into their ETC and their Malfurion, which is, I'm assuming, the pickups they would like to have here. Or they could move into also their Li Ming. Ooh, they actually go for ETC Tychus. And when you think about it, they actually have always had to deal with the opposing team picking Tychus first. So for the first time here, we're going to get some Dignitas in this series running Tychus.
Yeah, I think that's good. It's nice to see them picking that up now. It means that we may see Bakery on something other than Malfurion, which would also be nice. But it now puts Tricked Esports in a bit of an odd spot, considering that a lot of their drafts, I feel, have centered around the Warriors and the Warrior play. Like, Alex the Pro G, you know, being on a Mirrodin, not necessarily the thing he's most comfortable with, but he was always in the front. He was always making the plays. He was the sneaky Mirrodin for a lot of that start of the game, which tried to make things happen. So I think a lot of their play is focused around the Warriors at the moment.
Yeah, gotta agree with you. And we'll see if Tricked Esports in this best of five can get on the board here with that Warrior play, with Ragnaros helping out in these engagements. Ragnaros is great in general, too, on this battleground for the ability to delay the ultra phases. We've seen his strength in team fights. I do want to see more setup, though, from Tricked Esports. I want to see some isolation to where they can fall up with the Fierce Mash.
Yes.
And there is the Zeratul pickup.
Perfect. I like it. I really like it. So now they've got potential combos, which is nice. On Tricked Esports, I don't see anything other than a Malfurion ban, I feel, unless Dignitas... No, there's no way. that would be weird. So Diablo gets banned. Yeah, so they're focusing on trying to bring away a little bit of that Warrior power. They know that Tricked Esports has quite a focal point on that.
And we saw this yesterday. There was a Dig ban, they banned Diablo, and then here's a Malfurion banned out for Tricked Esports. And then Dig took Jaina with Mane running it. I mean, it wasn't the most impressive play I've seen from Mane before, but he did run it well enough to where he kept it away from the opposing team.
I think it's fine if they pick up a Jaina or something.
Yeah,
here.
It works here. You can have Tychus and ETC.
Yeah, you know, if a Mosh Pit ever lands, you're getting some big damage on towards that target. Mm-hmm. You've just got to take what we normally see for Jaina level 4 Frost Armor going up against Zeratul. It gives her a bit more safety and comfort against the current builds that we're seeing here from Zeratuls.
Which could put the burden here on Tricked Esports to go for the Anubarak, and then they have to finish up with another Warrior or Damage, which means their draft doesn't round out well.
I like all your thoughts.
Yeah, so you
I
pick
really
Jaina,
do.
You pick Arthas, and now Twitch Esports is this weird pinch in their fourth and fifth pick.
And we had that moment where Arthas was kind of like the protector of Jaina against the Anubarak in our previous day of games. So all of this is kind of rounding out in a very cool way.
Yeah, so I want to see how Twitch Esports handles this. Do they go multiple melee again? Against a Jaina and a Tychus in an ETC? Ew! That does not sound fun at all. So they have to go damage route, and I feel like a Anubarak Vala could work. The front line would be kind of in a bad spot against a Tychus and the Arthas. But I don't see double warrior working here, which the normal pickup would be go Anubarak and Muradin.
It's also melee heavy as well, right?
Yeah,
like that would be that would be some crazy stuff.
Dignitas just outdrafted Trick D-Sport here right now with these slots.
Surely it has to be Muradin, and then.
And then maybe you just don't go for the Anubarak, and then you trade out and go for some kind of a damage, a range. Liming is a possibility. Vala is a good possibility. Zul'jin, but we've yet to see that in EU. They move in Tyrael and Vala, so there we go. So now at least they have the Sanctification for the Ring of Frost. But now Dignitas has a fifth pick that they can really just kind of pull out here and use their advantage. I would like to see more disruption if possible. They have ETC and Arthas already, but they also have to pick up a healer. So they go for the Brightwing, and Brightwing does bring that Polymorph to deal with Zeratul and also that wonderful talent, Peekaboo.
All right, so we did see Trick D-Sport try and run a solo Tyrael for that warrior frontline in the past. Didn't have that much success. They're going to have to coordinate Ragnaros and Zeratul very well here. Void Prism's going to be it's important when you're going for the combos, because it's going to be super important to try and keep their entire composition like sturdy and not under huge threat.
Yeah, I think Zeratul here is more of a setup for Ragnaros or a pause button in both scenarios. You just, okay, a fight's broken out, let's go ahead and zone out the back line, and our Vala works in their auto attacks, and then we start winning the team fight and go from there. Tyrael is mostly reactive as a warrior, which is kind of scary to think about until 13-16 when he gets opposing and he gets the Holy Ground, but he's mostly here just to stop any major engagements happening on the opposing time, like an ETC Mosh Pit into a Jaina Ring of Frost. So it's going to be this weird chicken tug of war happening between Tyrael and the opposing team where late game gets strong because of Holy Ground, but can Trick Esport even get there? And I think Zeratul will be the one that we have to watch out to see if they get to that area, because he's going to have to be very pivotal around the altar phase in terms of getting picks.
Yeah, the Sanctification is something that can definitely turn the tide of battle.
Yes.
But with how well Dignitas has orchestrated their late game team fighting, I think that we'll see, once again, them kind of come out of the gate strong towards the later stages, especially.
Yeah, and Bakery, keep an eye on him, too, with that Brightwing. First time I think we've seen him play Brightwing here in the HGC. We've already seen Brightwings in the past, but Peekaboo is a wonderful talent to pick up for dealing with Zeratul. You have the Polymorph, too, for key pivotal moments. So, overall, I actually like Dignitas' draft a lot, but I'm cheering for Trick Esport, because I know this is the team that can do so well if they just really come together and show off their strengths.
We got to see the Brightwing once from Bakery, and he likes to do this weird combination of Arcane Flare build, which actually I think is really cool.
Cool.
Well, extra we'll little damage.
Well, it's game time. Game number three between our two teams. Best of five. Dignitas taking on Trick Esport. Can Trick Esport get on the scoreboard? We'll find out here on the far left. Please, Claris, the introductions.
Thank you very much, buddy. It's time for Team Dignitas to the left. Is Bakery going to be on Brightwing, the lovely little Schmetterling for Kaldor? And then we have JPL on ETC. Snitch going to be playing Tychus. We have Mene on Jaina. And finally, to round things out, it's Xaelia on Arthas once again.
And to the far right, Tricked Esport, the red team. Nappe is going to be playing the Rhaegar, one of his best supports. It feels like he's on Alex the Prodigy with the Tyrael. Crosby on Vala. And then rounding up the roster, Infernal on Zeratul. Let's keep an eye on him and how he deals with that Brightwing. And Rimmerballer on the Ragnaros.
All right. Yeah, my eyes are, I mean, as much as we have kept tabs on how Infernal's going to play his Zeratuls, etc., I'd love to see how Rimmerballer's going to be playing on this Ragnaros. We didn't get to see much chance. And look at this. Going for a tower. Dignitas, you can do it. We can do it better. Let's go.
Start burning it down. Vala works in those auto attacks. There's already a rotation here from ETC, which you have to watch out for. Alex the Prodigy does get the scout on, but the turret does not fall.
Disclaimer, they didn't do it better. Each time Dignitas killed it, and yeah, it's a bit of a smaller map. They'd all gone to the middle anyway. A little bit difficult to do. That's going to be an attack, though, on towards Alex the Prodigy, and he will fall. They're looking for a counter kill on Xelia or JPL. Oh, no. And JPL will be the victim.
Okay, one for one trade. Good for them. I think Alex the Prodigy actually threw his Enduron down, but it popped up right next to him, so he blinked into the third blizzard that killed him, which is unfortunate. That's what it looked like. I'll have to watch the replay to get the full vibe on that. But one for one trade for our team. The Brightwing is already in the bottom lane soaking, so a slight lead for Dignitas.
Look at this. We're back to Monster Hunter on a map that isn't BOE for Valor. Fun times.
New meta. So now they have a boss rush, or boss rush potential, and they also can get mercenaries.
Yep.
Vala build here for Trick Esport.
Nice to see. Interesting that it's making its way in a little bit more than just Battlefield of Eternity. We saw it yesterday, obviously, and now we get to see it again. Let's see what Dignitas is going to pose as a threat here. Eternal Crosby looking to put on damage towards Bakery. Quite a bit of damage, but Bakery is a fast butterfly with those little shields.
And he turns around immediately here, and that indicates to Trick Esport that they're being chased down. There goes the power slide, mana here as well, the rotation on point for Dignitas, and that'll be another takedown here right before the three altar phase. Now, they all will be spawning right when it happens, but still, Team Dignitas getting that kill gives them experience to get to level 4 and also gives them the advantage of being able to set up for this three altar phase to maybe take two away.
Right, so let's see, Team Dignitas here looking to just take their altar initially. And a bit of an engagement down towards bottom. Snitch might be under a lot of threat. Alex Prochi has to turn around, try and save Crosby. Not to be the case, though. Valor will fall. Mene getting a really good flank.
And the thing is, too, is Dignitas is looking for more. They're channeling in the top right here on the third altar already. Xelia takes it. Now, Rhaegar has already begun down here. Nappe, Bakery walks in to get the auto attack. No, he decides to pull on back. But for a second there, Dignitas was primed to potentially take all three altars. That's how strong their map control has been this early game.
And for Tricked Esport, I think that, you know, with this kind of Valor build, it doesn't add as much to the team fight. We mentioned it yesterday. We went through it yesterday, kind of the pros and cons of this build. So unless Tricked Esport does gain some momentum with that a little bit early, try and take some of those camps, etc., with Valor faster, I think they're going to be in a little bit of a bad spot towards the later stages of the game.
Yeah, I like the thought that Crisplosion mentioned about it, is that you normally aren't going to be in your attacks anyways against the opposing team. Jaina has great poke, so Val's going to have a hard time really trying to work in her auto attacks. And then you have Arthas and ETC that can engage any point. So just going for this Hungering Arrow build gives you the poke that's capable, but not making you or not forcing you to get a ton of stacks before you get value out of her. So it kind of makes sense in the meta that we're currently in, with so many warriors that can dive on your squishy assassins that are so robust, allow them to go for poke builds. Eternal, though, in trouble already.
So much damage coming out from Mene there, and Bakery will just teleport away to JPL in the safety, and Mene may end up falling, though. Yes, he will. That is going to be the second kill for Tricked Esports as they back away for the moment, and sappers versus sappers killing off one another.
Gonna clear those up. Would have been nice to have a Jaina here, though. That Blizzard would have been wonderful for that wave.
Yeah.
At the same time, Xelia does start grabbing the mercs at the very north, though, so he will have his own sappers pushing in. And now we are into the two altar phase between Dignitas and Tricked Esport. One to the top left and one to the top right. In terms of positioning, Tricked Esport is actually in a really good spot already.
I was mentioning something earlier that, actually, you kind of... Well, we watch this go down.
And he lives.
Fine.
Bakery shows up, but that is phase shift down and peekaboo.
Yeah, so you were mentioning that peekaboo is really strong, and I don't know why I then started talking about the fact that Bakery does go for Arcane Flare build, because he does sometimes, but the peekaboo thing is just too strong against a Zeratul, etc. So, yeah, I don't know why I started mentioning the Arcane Flare build.
Well, it's still a good build. It's one to run. I just think that peekaboo is too good on this battleground in particular.
Having the vision
around these chokes that we just saw right above this. All those bushes. Yeah, see this entire choke area? Thank you, Broside, by the way. Amazing observing. Oh, this entire area here on the left side, if you get a peekaboo up, you can just engage the way you want to instead of having the phase check. It's just such a strong talent for Towers of Doom in particular, but even better, as you mentioned, against the Zeratul.
Got to agree with that. Now we'll see Xelia just... He's the camp master by the looks of things in this game at the moment, just sending him to every single one. That Frozen Tempest will clean things up nice and fast. And ETC towards the top, middle lane even, is going on towards Ragnaros, but can't really do much with that.
And for the most part, Dignitas slightly ahead, but Tricked Esport is holding in right now.
Yeah.
They're holding on here, moving towards level 10, only 32 to 28, 4 points behind. And they are constantly being ganked, but we are seeing players like Alex Aproji getting out of these fights, and Ethernal as well. There have been a few more kills that could have occurred, but they're doing just enough to help each other out to survive these pushes, and they're getting Merc Camp. So for the most part, Trick Esport is holding it relatively well after a what I would call a lackluster early game.
And noticeably, we're seeing big focus on those two mercenary camps towards the bottom lane. They are coming in thick and furious. Every single time they respawn, it seems like both teams are prioritizing that, getting more damage done where they can, trying to escort it here and there. So I like that they're timing those out really well. They both keep clashing every single time. So 1 minute left on those. Let's see if they continue to prioritize that or if they're going to take look for a 10-team fight.
Yeah, it's crazy how the dynamic changes so much when you don't focus on globals, because globals are about soaking and getting a lead. But when you have teams that are great at team fight, which both teams have right now, getting those mercenary camps are pivotal. And you see how the teams adjust. Great point there by Polaris.
Are they going to go?
They might be. The level 10 is instrumental, though. Trick Esport needs it here. There they go. They get it.
Oof, and they locked those in very fast. So Ancestral Healing, Reign of Vengeance, Sulfura, Smash, Void Prison, and then finally Sanctification on that side. They see the vision here while they're trying to tussle for this. JPL at the front, zoning them out. But that Herogic Reforging means that Alex Aproji will have his Eldarun's Might up nice and quickly up towards the top, though. Crosby manages to get the Ancestral Healing. JPL in the thick of things. It's a four-man mosh almost. No, Valor is off the court on the side, but that's going to be a Ring of Frost. Sanctification's tried to be used to save someone. It's going to be a one-for-one trade to start things off.
That was an incredible fight. The mosh pit came off, the Reign of Vengeance went to go for the interrupt, but I believe Bakery came in and gave a cleanse, so they get an extra second of mosh pit to focus down the targets they wanted. They pick off Bala, and they also pick off Rhaegar. Now, Ragnaros will be able to delay for a bit here. There's 10 seconds, though, until we have the Rhaegar back on the field. Dignitas should be able to grab this altar. Wonderful team fight. Nice heads up by JPL, and great play by Bakery.
It was a good Ring of Frost as well on the side of Mene. He did a lot of damage to that comp. I'm surprised more didn't die there on the side of Trick Esport, considering how well he'd lined that up. But it will be now the camp straight away, get them challenging each other. And again, you know, we'll see them come down here very soon, just a bit.
32-24 for our teams. And Trick Esport right now needs to work on just getting the experience, keeping their pushing going. For the most part, they have really good teamfight capabilities just set up for the next time that you have your heroics available. Dignitas, though, going for the brave play here and goes straight into the boss call. Peekaboo will reveal that Trick Esport is aware of it, but the problem is Ragnaros just left his lane. So Trick Esport is fighting a man down over this boss.
Yep, that should be okay for them to get here. Tyrael will get blown up there. And actually, so will ETC under the fire of that Sulfura smash. Xaelia on the retreat on out. Blink heal from Bakery to keep him alive. So that's okay. One for one for four shots. I think that's a pretty winning trade there.
Yep, not a bad take at all there for Dignitas. And it all comes down to just knowing where your opponents are at and the timing that you have to burn down said boss. So great call by them. Trick Esport now needs to get to the rotations and get to 13. Now, that kill did give them a little bit of that comeback experience that can be so juicy because they were slightly behind, and they also got a little bit more of a wave in the bottom lane. So now Trick Esport does take a lead experience.
I wonder if down the line in HGC Europe we'll see more focus on maps or map pick compared, because I feel like this series so far has been heavily going in Dignitas's favor purely because we're just on maps that they're really good at. I mean, it can always be hard going up against the big three as we have a Void Prism coming in now. How are they going to play this out? Alex Aproji going to land down the Sanctification right next to it, looking for damage, but no follow-up. Everyone gets away there for Dignitas. They don't really have the stuns. The Reign of Vengeance needs to be absolutely on point for them to get some damage there.
Yeah, good Blizzard from Mene there on the bottom right to delay the opposing team from going for the aggression that they would like. But yeah, back to your point earlier, I think map picks will be a thing down the line. HGC sets you up to know your opponent so you can find out what they're weak at and what you're great at.
Yeah, and we keep seeing the bans from all of these guys, and there's a following, there's a trend, you know. So some teams are banning Warhead Junction constantly, some teams are banning Battlefield of Eternity constantly, and they only get one ban. So maybe you can play around with that. But for now, JPL out the front, knocking those guys back, snitches in the fight towards the top, but just delaying Ethernal at the moment.
The dance continues. Ethernal almost having that altar, but Snitch with a clutch grenade will prevent Ethernal from grabbing said altar. The first one does go to Dignitas on the bottom, and the second one is being set up already for them as well. Alex Aproji sets up for now Druin. So Fierce Smash does connect with Jaina. There's a mosh pit, but instantly stopped there.
They got it.
JPL low on HP. Ethernal sharking here for a kill on the left side.
Yeah, the Trick played this fight really, really well. That's going to be Arthas going down. really good start there. And also now Crosby has more power behind him because he has Siphoning Arrow at 13. He can be kind of a little bit more forwards with his positioning and thus get a bit more damage out.
Yeah.
So that's good.
And then just vault away, get a reset. Next thing you know, you're sacking some health back and you're good to go. And that Zeratul that chased you is suddenly out of mobility abilities. Or not Zeratul, the ETC, if you will. Anyone that's trying to get on your face can be dealt with relatively well. So Xanatos now up 2-0 still on this team, 28-16. But Trick Esports is turning it up. Pressure on the bottom left of the sports.
All right, so we're going to put on some pressure at the front here once again. That's ETC already falling. This is a great Void Prism. Do they have Sulfurous Smash? Do they have anything? They have a few abilities. That's going to be Sanctification. Pop down there so they can blow up Jaina. Sulfurous Smash only just came off cooldown like 2 or 3 seconds after that Void Prism. So I can see why they don't use it. They got themselves a kill anyway.
First two things that disgust me. One, that tweet, decapitated head from Brywing. Jeez, man, that guy bringing up Brywing. And then secondly, where did Jaina go in that fight? She was eliminated instantly in that fight. Great job by Trick Esport. And they're starting to trickle deaths here on Xanatos, which is opening them up for the map. They've got the map in the bottom left. They've also got the port here in the middle. And they're on the way to 16. And they are going to start spiking relatively hard at 16. You get your Vala damage build starting to come together. Your Zeratul really going to be able to start blinking around and bring out the damage as well. But the Tyrael, in particular, Holy Ground, comes online.
Yeah, I mean, it's an interesting way they're doing this, because oftentimes you would see against a Zeratul, Sanctification on the opposing team, just try and stop any damage going from the Void Prism. But the way that Trick Esports is playing this is like, we have a Void Prism, we know you're there, we're going to make ourselves invincible. You only have one option, run. And if you cannot run, you are going to die. So I really kind of like how they're orchestrating these fights.
Run or die. Sounds like the obvious option.
Yeah.
Pick number one. Nape grabs the altar down here on the bottom right. Tychus is trying to delay it. He actually does get it. Zelia on the right side here gets some pressure on Crosby. Crosby will kite away and bring out that Hungering Arrow. Zelia kiting away at the same time. Alex Approji on the top left has an Aldruin, so he can dive in. Zeratul is floating around. Now Void Prison and Sanctification is available for Trick Esports.
Yeah, looking to power themselves down towards the bottom left-hand corner here as well, but that's going to be Nape getting mashed up against the right-hand side there of the map. And Alex Approji, there's not much they can do here. They can try and delay, but they may as well just give this one away.
Yeah, they're going to have to give it up, especially when they lose their healer. Just a prolonged fight, it just would not work out for them, even with that siphoning impact available for Vala. So now the game suddenly tied, 16-16, about to hit for both teams in the next few seconds. And Xanatos is actually very ahead in terms of control of the map, though. 24-8 in shots. Trick Esports is getting into desperation mode.
And a great little blink heal away there from Bakery as he was under pressure. And that's going to be a mosh pit onto just one, but it's enough to pick up a Ragnaros kill. And Team Dignitas, you know, for some of the faults here in this game, they're really finding themselves some great little pickoffs. Could be Alex Approji next.
Alex Approji does get picked off. He's even able to use Aldruin. That is two members taken out. Now, Rhaegar did spawn, is on the way, but Dignitas should be able to take his boss for free.
Yeah, it's the perfect pickup. You kill a Tyrael, he doesn't have Holy Ground, you don't have Sanctification anymore, so just take the boss. What are they going to do? They're going to Void Prism this? He's going to try.
Void Prism goes out, and they try to get a 3v3. Can Infernal hop in, though? He was hit by the Frost of Jaina. Now Jaina is now out of the Void Prism, is unleashed, and Mane goes to the engage on Nape, hits him here. Will Nape get away? The Blizzard connecting. Here's the Ice Lance in a second, and there is the snipe. Dignitas taking out Trick Esports once again, 24-4, and this game is looking over.
It's a shame that they try, like, I understand why they tried to make that play happen, because, you know, it's desperate times require desperate measures here for Trick Esports, but it's super ambitious there, just trying to get the blow up on someone that was on the point. So anyway, that's going to be it. They're going to move on away from this as well. Brywing's pushing at the bottom, actually.
Was that a coordinated play to try to get the Ragnaros Molten Core out?
Maybe.
Feels like it was from Dignitas. They put just enough pressure. They had a tank that was low on HP. You're not going to all in that.
Because now, I mean, they require poke for this tribute, or they might require poke for the tribute, and it's Molten Core has just finished, and that tribute, this shrine, finishes the game.
Yeah.
So if Dignitas just wins this without having to deal with a lot of poke, that could be definitely in the play.
Oh, Dignitas so smart, Kalaris.
Yeah.
So smart, so intelligent. And now Trick Esports has to find a way to not allow Dignitas to get this altar and not kill their entire team. Zelia starts to poke here with Arthas. Jaina is on the bottom right. JPL set up here.
Void Prism, 10 seconds. Super important. Void Prism, 10 seconds away. They're going to go for the fight here before it's even up at the moment. I don't think they realize that it's not there just yet, but Snitch 13, quite a bit of damage from Eternal. 1 second on Void Prism. They need to make something happen right now.
Ancestral goes off. There's the Void Prism. A 5v3 setup. Can they kill Zelia? They're focusing him.
Oh!
The Void Prism goes out. There's the Ring of Frost on Crosby in the back right, but there's no one there to do the damage. And Trick Esports holds. They hold Glarus.
That Void Prism coming off at just the right time so that they can secure themselves a lifeline here in this game and this series.
JBL getting a little bit too aggressive there, flirting with disaster, but does pull away with the help of Bakery. Now, Trick Esports has not grabbed this altar yet. They're trying to get as much as they can here for this altar. They get the mercenaries to push the bottom left. They're going to try and take this altar here so they get at least 4 shots out of it, and then they can start grabbing the altar.
All right, so yeah, that's a good little strategy here for them. They want absolutely every shot that they can possibly muster. We saw in North America last night in the HGC that there was a game that went down to 1 shot. 1 shot, so it really does matter, as many as you can possibly get.
That it does, and they're trying to get more. Could this be too greedy? They're grabbing mercenaries in the bottom right, so they get those pushing. They could potentially take the fort also and get another shot available for them, because Dignitas is fully up. Now, Dignitas won't have their mosh pit for 40 seconds, and Void Prison is up in 30 seconds. That means they technically have a 10-second window to get a pick off again and take the entire battleground.
It's also a good strategy, I think, for Trick Esports to remind you here, is because they're behind an experience right now, and altar shots don't get you experience, but they need to catch up in experience for the next altars when it comes to, you know, trying to rival them when level 20 is hit for Team Dignitas. So I really like what they're doing here with the delay. Now they're in a situation where Dignitas is back, so this could just end the game again. But if they win the fight and then continue on, they could be in good step for the later stages.
This altar is their lifeline. Eternal on the back right. Sanctification popped early. This means the Void Prison can't come out. There's the Void Prison. Ring of Frost does connect with 3 members, though. Sulfurous Smash does miss, and Dignitas turns the fight around, diving into Nappe. There's a mosh pit on Tyrael and Crosby in the bottom right. Eternal cannot do anything, and this will be curtains here for Trick Esports as 4 members die, potentially a 5th as Eternal will blink away.
Yeah, it's curtains. There's actually a lot to say about all these situations, and it comes back to what I was saying about the experience, because some people will be like, well, why didn't they just take it towards the last seconds? But you've got to think about all stages of the game. You've got to, like, it's good and dandy that they would have got these shots from this. But anyway, that is going to be it. Dignitas will be successful here and complete this as they finish off that core. 3-0 to Team Dignitas.
Dignitas allowed this one there, kills the fort in the bottom left to make sure they get those 4 shots, and that's GG.
Yeah.
3-0 for Dignitas. They'll walk away with another victory. Now 2-1 in the HEC, but sadly, Trick Esports goes to 0-3. Hard start for the team.
Yeah, yeah. And you know, I want to reiterate on what we just saw there again. It's, you know, you can walk back and get that shrine, but they're thinking about, okay, if we get this, where can we then still come back in the later stages? And it was all about collecting that experience in that window that they had. Unfortunately for them, you know, they didn't get enough. They didn't win that fight then afterwards.
Yeah, something to consider is that if they win that team fight, they could take all of the bell towers and win the game.
Then
they get the
7
shots, they get the running going, and they can just hold out the front line. So they went for the all-in play there. It makes sense from a strategy point of view. It's really hard to pull off against a team like Dignitas, but I like they went for it. You know, kind of opening up the avenues there for comebacks on that battleground.
Yeah, yeah, because it can be difficult otherwise. It can be very difficult otherwise there. So commiserations to Trick Esports that I think, again, you know, going they've had 3 very tough opponents. Not only have they had 2 of the big 3, but they also had Expert to go up against as well, who were very powerful, and I'm sure they'll do better towards the next weeks.
All right, well, it's time to talk to Bakery from Dignitas. Bakery, can you hear me?
I can.
Oh, hello. How are you?
I'm feeling pretty good. Obviously had a much better showing today than yesterday, and I'm pretty happy about that.
Awesome. So it seems like your team is starting to get on track for victory here. The first week, obviously, you had a really hard matchup, but it seems like you guys are trying to figure out some things in the draft. How are you guys feeling right now in terms of week after week with HGC and how you're evolving as a team?
I think a lot of what we're doing right now is about finding yourself as a team. We've got a new player, obviously. Yeah. We've got a new kind of structure in game, like the way that we shot core and the way that we draft, and we're kind of finding out the intricacies of that and how it affects us in game. And I think we're getting pretty good right now. I'm feeling really good about the team.
Awesome.
I've got a question. What do you think about the Warrior meta right now? Obviously, you guys in draft are going towards ETC at the very beginning of these drafts. But then we're seeing a lot of teams going for very heavy front lines and stuff like that. Where do you see ETC in all of that? Obviously, quite highly, I suppose. And then where do you see the other Warriors as a metric?
I think ETC is obviously quite a bit of head. I think Warriors are actually in a great spot right now. You can pick almost anything. Mm. Obviously, Diablo is really good in certain situations, same with Tyrael. But for us, we think that ETC gives us control of the game, and it lets us set the pace.
Right.
And that's what we care about a lot, actually.
Okay.
Awesome. Bakery, I just want to ask about Zelia. I asked Niche about it yesterday, but that guy is really coming into his own. What does he bring to this team that you guys feel like you've missed in the past?
I honestly believe that mechanically, Zelia is one of the best players in the world. And I have absolutely no doubt about that. I think he's still quite young as a player. He's still, obviously, he's role swapped. So it's an entirely new role for him. It's entirely new heroes. But I really do think that he will become the best player in Europe, given enough time.
Man, we'll have to see if that happens. I just want to ask you about your next matchup before we let you go. You're facing off against Team Expert next Saturday, and Expert has come out swinging here in the HEC. How are you guys feeling about it?
So obviously this is going to be the matchup that kind of decides which team is going to be going to Katowice, in my opinion. I think they're really strong in draft. Obviously ADRD bring a lot of weird stuff to the table, but also very solid strategy as well. I think the way that we see the matchup is if we're able to figure them out and just take it to an even matchup, then we should be really fine. But if they come out with some weird stuff and we're really not ready for them, then we might have some issues.
Awesome. Well, we wish you the best of luck. And again, congratulations once again on the comebacks. Please, again, before we let you go, shout outs. What do you want to yell about before we let you go?
So shout-outs to Team Dignitas, of course, and my team. They're amazing. And obviously, huge thanks to Heroes Hearth for sponsoring me, and you can follow me there.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Bakery, and again, congratulations to the rest of Dignitas. Now, we'll be setting up for our next series of the day, and of course, we'll be showing you all the fun stuff. But again, I just want to get your thought before we leave on that entire series. Dignitas looks well-composed, and it's great to see that from them.
Yeah, it definitely is. And one thing that actually I can take away from the interview is that one of my absolute favorite fixtures for the entire Phase 1 was, you know, I've said it many times now, is the Dignitas versus Expert match. And it's good to see that Team Dignitas also sees that and respects that match.
Yeah.
Because for me, that, as Bakery says, it's one of the big deciders to see who goes to Katowice. So it's week 4 that we actually get to see that go down, I think.
It's next Saturday, so week 3.
Oh, week
actually,
3.
We
okay.
get to see it in week 3.
So, it's going to be amazing.
It's going to be amazing. It's good to see that respect. I totally agree with you, because Expert right now is a team that I just watch and I see almost perfection, it seems like. I know it's hard to get the perfect game, but Expert right now, in terms of team fights and drafts, is just really getting up there and really are fighting to be in that top 3.
Mm-hmm.
Later on today, we will be looking at the next matchup, which is Playing Ducks taking on the Misfits, which I'm pretty excited about. I want to know if Playing Ducks has a chance with Sport Billy doing such a good job yesterday, just being a playmaker, if he can even take on the Misfits here, who is arguably one of the best teams in Europe.
Yeah, they're looking good. They were able to defeat Fnatic in a strong series. So Playing Ducks is going to have their work absolutely cut out for them here. We just saw a 3-0. I wouldn't be surprised if we saw another 3-0 here because of how strong Misfits is right now in Europe.
Yeah, I think I agree with you. Misfits is, gosh, they're just such a strong team. And Playing Ducks, while we did have a surge of life from them yesterday, I just don't know if they're on that level now. We're working on a highlight reel for you guys. We're going to show you what happened during that entire 3-0. So let's go ahead and check out the highlight reel from Dignitas taking on Tricked Esports. So at the very beginning of it all, we had a strange 3-warrior comp from Tricked Esports, and I was expecting it to be powerful, but Snitch had different plans with the Mighty Gust into the Engage, Zelia with the follow-up, the wonderful Twilight Dream from Bakery to prevent the Sanctification, and they just got a full team wipe there.
Yeah, so you can see just very, very strong. I mean, you saw and you heard from Bakery the fact that ETC is able to control a lot of the pace for them. And also, Jay plays it with meticulous play. And Nappy there, just a slight step too far forwards will confirm his death.
Team?
Team? Earthquake? Question mark?
Where are you at? Another engage. This was on the Towers of Doom Battleground. Alex Approji goes in for the engage, and he's getting lasered the entire time now. He had a clutch Ancestral Healing, and his Void Prison was wonderful, but it's all about buying time here. The minute the Void Prison did conclude, there was a turnaround in the engage. Now, Trick Esports did great in that fight, and this was the last altar of the phase, but we saw everyone respawn once again and move into the engagement and eventually grab that altar. Yep. All right, so where are we at in the HGC after that matchup? Where does our team stand? Let's go ahead and look at it here. Team Expert continues to be at the top. We'll watch Misfits next, but Dignitas has snuck their way up to the top three with that 2-1 victory. Fnatic obviously will have something to say about that when we watch them tomorrow. Synergy.